Well, praise the Lord, everyone, and welcome to the broadcast of the Nazarene Baptist Church.
Sunday School, Sundays at 8:30 a.m. Virtual Bible Study, Wednesday at 7 p.m. On behalf of Lady Davis and Elder Vini, thank you to everyone who came out to the Secret Sister Fellowship. Thank you to everyone who spoke, everyone who helped out, and everyone who participated. Powerful Movement Worship Center for Christ, 5th Pastoral Church Anniversary, Sunday, October 8th at 3 p.m. with guest preacher, our very own Pastor Davis.
How can we pray for you? If you have a prayer request, please send them to care@nazarenebaptist.org.
Happy birthday to all of our October-born members.
We have three ways to give. You can give your offering by mail to our P.O. Box. You can give your offering through Tithely to Nazarene Baptist Church. Or you can text GIVE to 833-402-2068.
Well, we greet you again this morning. This morning, our topic is exploring what we call the process. God often puts us or allows us to go through certain things in our lives just to get to a certain point that He has already ordained for our lives. We call that the process. And today we're going to explore some of the things that God allows us to go through and still realize and recognize that He is still sovereign and that He is still God. Join us for today's lesson as we look into the process. God bless you. God bless you, brothers and sisters. This is the day that the Lord has made, and we shall rejoice and be glad in it. For the Lord is good, His mercy is everlasting, and His truth endures unto all generations. What a joy it is to be alive on this, the Lord's day. And we are thankful and we appreciate the gift of God's mercy that's upon our lives. Brothers and sisters, I want to encourage you today that in the midst of life's trials and challenges, it is easy to feel overwhelmed as well as discouraged. However, as followers of Christ, we can take solace in the fact that our Heavenly Father knows as well as understands our situations intimately. He is not distant, nor is He unaware. Rather, He is intimately acquainted with every detail of our lives. So today, I want to encourage you by reminding you of the profound truth that God knows your situation and that He is your ultimate solution. No matter what you are going through today, whether in your personal life or in your professional life, God knows everything about your situation. He knows your everyday struggles as well as your victories and defeats. He knows your expectations of Him. He knows your difficulties, your addictions, your joys, as well as your sorrows. He knows your family situations as well as your strengths and your weaknesses. He knows your financial situations as well as your state of health. So I encourage you today to put your situation in His hands through prayer and thanksgiving, and He will be able to bring you the help and comfort that you need. If you are sick and you have health problems, don't forget that He is able to heal you, because He is still the doctor of doctors. So present your situation to Him, because He is able to deliver you. And with that said, would you join me now in a word of prayer? Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus, we give you glory, honor, and thanks for this day. Another opportunity to witness your power, your glory, and your grace. Thank you, Lord, for saving us and providing for us. Thank you, Lord, for the humble opportunity and privilege of having a relationship with you. Thank you for creating us and converting us and challenging us and consoling us, yet God, empowering us to do your work and to continue to do your will here on the earth. Lord, we give you praise and glory, for this is the day that you have made, and God, we choose to rejoice and be glad in it. Thank you for the opportunity to gather online, to learn your word and to improve upon our discipleship. We thank you now, O God, for the Holy Ghost. We pray for the forgiveness of sins. We pray for strength. We pray for compassion. We pray for comprehension, O God, revelation as well as application, God, that we may live out your word through our lives. We pray now, God, for every household that's listening this morning, for every man, every woman, every family, especially those, oh God, who resides under this covering. Bless them today, Father. Whether they are sick, we pray that you heal them. Where there is a need, oh God, we ask that you would provide for them, Lord. If they need a breakthrough, Lord, let this be the day of their breakthrough. If they need uplifting in their spirit, oh God, break through that barrier of depression and despair and lift your people unto the joy of the Lord in the name of Jesus. Lord, and we ask, oh God, that you would bless our leaders and our staff and all of our ministries, oh God, every member of this church and beyond, oh God. And we pray now, Lord, that you would continue to lift up the Nazarene Baptist Church to be a beacon of light in the community and throughout the world for your glory. Sanctify us now, oh God, for the purposes of learning, hearing, and applying your word through your Holy Spirit. Lord, we pray for your power, your grace, your love, as well as your peace to be our portion today. So, Lord, as we lift up those who may be physically challenged in any way today, or even emotionally challenged in any kind of way, we pray that this be the day of wholeness for them in the name of Jesus. Oh, God, and to all our brothers and sisters who are in the hospitals or who may be even in prison, oh, God, to anyone who may be in any kind of challenged state, Lord, would you allow this time to be a time of grace and peace and joy for them? For Father, we still believe for your miracles, signs, and wonders. And we, God, we thank you for it right now in the matchless and marvelous and majestic name of our Lord and soon coming King, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen and amen. We praise and thank the Lord again for yet another beautiful day, a new day to experience the power and the glory and the majesty of God Almighty. He reigns, and he reigns alone, and he reigns supreme. He is sovereign and self-sufficient. He has no beginning, and he has no end. He is our God, the only true, wise, and living God, who sent his Son Jesus Christ to die for us and to die as us. He raised his Son from the dead sent the Holy Ghost to guide our lives from the inside out. And we are so grateful and thankful for the opportunity again to be a part of the body of Christ. I want to say a good God bless you to everyone this morning. I pray that your week was pleasurable, and even if it wasn't, God still allowed you to get through it to this point. So we give him the glory for all things, and we thank him in all things. Amen. If you would grab your copy of God's Word and turn with me to the book of Deuteronomy, the 32nd chapter, and we'll begin reading from the King James Version right there at verse number 4. And it reads as thus: He is my rock, his work is perfect, for all his ways are judgment, a God of truth and without iniquity. Just and right is he. They have corrupted themselves. Their spot is not the spot of his children. They are a perverse and crooked generation. Do ye thus require the Lord, O foolish people and unwise? Is not he thy father that has brought thee? Has not he made thee and established thee? Remember the days of old. Consider the years of many generations. Ask thy father, and he will show thee, thy elders, and they will tell thee. When the Most High divided into the nations their inheritance, when he separated the sons of Adam, he sent the bounds of the people according to the number of children of Israel. For the Lord's portion is his people. Jacob is the lot of his inheritance. He found him in a desert land and in the waste howling wilderness. He led him about. He instructed him. He kept him as the apple of his eye. This morning I want to lift up to you as a title, Don't Fight the Process. There is something within all of us that likes to be in control. And if we're honest today, all of us have a sense of personal autonomy where we like to navigate the circumstances and affairs of our lives without God's permission. You see, there's a part of us that wants to be a control freak at times, right? We all like to be on the God squad. We want to tell God how we think our situations ought to work out. But God is so amazing that every now and then he'll take us through a series of experiences just to let us know that he does not need our opinion or our input, because he knows exactly what he's doing. You see, when God moves, he already has a strategy. He always has the end game in mind. And though you may offer God suggestions, please understand this, that God's ways are perfect and his plans has already been established in the heavens. And what's important here to understand, people of God, is that how God works is through a process. And then God brings us to a place of destiny. And you must understand that life is not a sprint, but it's a marathon. We've heard that several times. It's something that takes steps. It is a process. And all of us at times resist this thing called process, because there's something within all of us that enjoys instant gratification. We've got instant coffee, instant foods, instant teas, instant marriages, instant everything. Why? Because we want it right away. But you must understand that God works in processes. That's why many people in this generation are now in trouble, because they love taking the elevator versus taking the stairs. Because the way God works is one step here And then you learn, and one step there, and then you learn some more. And all of these steps are a part of our development. You see, here in the process of God preparing you for where he is taking you, he will not release you into something until you have been properly prepared for it. And so our natural proclivity is to resist it. Our flesh hates processes. As a matter of fact, you might recall Jesus suffering as a man in the Garden of Gethsemane. Now remember when he was in that place. Jesus, the man who was suffering, said, "Father, if it be possible, let this cup, let this process pass from me." But he was God enough to step in and say, "But not my will, but thy will be done." Process. It's where you learn things about God that you otherwise would have never known. Process. It's where you learn things about people around you. Process. It's when you learn things about yourself. It's an amazing thing to go through. Process. And you must understand something, people of God, because on the other side of process is where God elevates us and takes us to new dimensions. And so today, I want to really talk to somebody and help you to understand that everything inside of you may be resisting the process, but God's word to you today is don't fight it, don't resist it, because God could be getting ready to take you to something that's literally going to blow your mind. For every tear you cried, for every experience that you went through was not wasted. God's going to use it all, because all things are still working together for good to those who love God and are called according to his purposes. But there are some people who are literally looking over their lives right now and thanking God for everything that they had to go through. Because if they had not gone through it, they wouldn't be as strong as they are or as wise as they are right now. They're giving God the glory for stuff that other people are still complaining about. They're saying, "Lord, thank you for every fake friend, because now I know who my real friends are. Thank you for everybody who left me, because it may have ruined all the new folk that you were trying to send into my life. Thank you for every mountain, every valley, every storm that you brought me through. If I never had a problem, I would have not have known what faith in your word could do for me. But through it all, I've learned how to lean and depend on you." But for Israel, this is a very interesting place here in Deuteronomy. You see, when this song comes out, Israel was known by the many songs that they would sing. And this song is a very interesting one, because there were two things in the life of the children of Israel. As they were here now, desert babies, or they were pilgriming, they were headed somewhere, in other words. But they were in an interesting spot. And there were two things that they had to remember while they were in this process. The first thing they had to be keenly aware of was who God is. They had to be clear now, because remember, what they had previously known about God was based on second and third hand information. What they had known about God was based on an oral tradition, what someone had told them. But now they're moving into another space where God would be real to them individually as well as corporately, based on the experiences that God had given them. You see, there is a moment when you heard that God was a healer. But then there's that moment when you graduated and now you know for yourself that God is a healer. There's a moment when you heard that God was a waymaker. But then when your back was up against the wall, you found out that God was a waymaker. Hallelujah. You don't need nobody else to tell you what you know for yourself, because some people are still depending upon fossilization and catechism, and you're depending on what someone else is teaching you in some classroom about God. But there are some of us who have been to hell and back, been drugged through the mud, and we found out for ourselves that there is not a friend like the lonely Jesus. No, not one. And somebody ought to shout that I know him for myself. Glory. But then there was a second thing that Israel had to remember. Not only who God was, but they had to be keenly aware of who they were. You see, their identity was going to be important. They could not live vicariously through anybody else. They had to know who they were, their corporate identity, their individual identity. And like many of you, you've got to be clear about who you are also. You got to be comfortable in your own skin. You got to be confident in how God made you and how God has wired you. You see, God knew exactly who you were when he made you. He made you like he made you, like he wanted to make you. He made you like he wanted to be. God made your head like your head was supposed to be. He made your hips like he wanted your hips to be. He made your lips like he wanted your lips to be. And you ain't got to argument anything. You ain't got to change it. If people don't like it, say, go your way and I'm going to go my way. And may the Lord watch between me and thee while we're absent one from another. You see, I'm cool in how God made me. I know who I am. I am fearfully and wonderfully made. I am the head and not the tail. I know who I am. And when you know who you are and you know whose you are, there is nothing you go through that God can't get you through. So the process here for many of us right now, you see, we're trying to navigate through this ambiguous space called process, because you know you're on your way to something. And to get to this marvelous vision that we have seen and we're trying to get to. But God has got us in this space and in this place called process. Now let's see if we can understand and unpack this and think about what God is trying to show us while we're on our way to it. Here it is. I think it's important to understand, first of all, the righteousness of God. Because see, first of all, we have to understand that God's ways are always right. There is a very interesting thing that's being spoken here in the text. His ways are righteous. His ways are right. The righteousness of God suggests that God's ways are always right, regardless of how our situation may turn out. God's righteousness is not hinged upon us affirming his righteousness, because God is inherently righteous. As a matter of fact, there were some things that God did that made that felt like God had left us. But then when you look back over your life and you thank God for it, because his ways were right. Here it is. Let me talk to you. There were some people that you were holding on to, and you had to be with them, couldn't live without them. But then God said that that ain't right for you. But then you kicked and you screamed. But then just a few years later, you saw them in the mall with someone else, and you said, Lord, hallelujah, thank you. Because if I knew then what I know now, oh, somebody ought to shout and say he is righteousness. You see, he sees the future. His ways are right. And it may not feel right to you while it's happening to you, but you got to remember that God is a righteous God, and no good thing will he withhold from those who walk uprightly. We are his children, and when we walk according to his word, he rewards us according to his righteousness. But not only that, righteousness has a cousin, and the cousin of righteousness is sovereignty. Let the church say sovereignty. Now, the sovereignty of God suggests that God can do whatever God wants to do, how God wants to do it, and to whom God wants to do it with. And God owes no one an explanation as to why he does what he does. He is under no rule other than himself. And so here, the sovereignty of God, once it's imposed upon our lives, we must be willing to accept the blessings as well as the burden, no matter how it comes. There are many people who look at you now and wonder, why is God blessing you? Why has God chosen you? And all you got to do is say, hey, God is sovereign, and I don't control his sovereignty. Hallelujah. I'm just an heir of his favor. You see, God will skip over people just to bless somebody else. And I can't get mad if God is blessing my neighbor, because at least I know that he's in the neighborhood. I'm trying to help somebody here today. God is a sovereign God, and whatever God does, it's always right. He always has a plan, and he always plans to do it. And so here we see the righteousness of God, and God is righteous. God is sovereign. But here it is. God is also a great God, and I will ascribe greatness unto our God. So you are telling me today, Pastor, that I am just supposed to say that God is a great God when I got all of these challenges going on in my life, huh? Are you telling me, Pastor, here that in the process that I'm supposed to just throw my hands up and say that God is a great God just because? Are you telling me here, Pastor, that from all the stuff I got going on my job and inside of my house, that I'm just supposed to say that God is still a great God? Oh, yeah. He's a great God. As a matter of fact, when you check the record, when you look carefully at how good and how great God is, you might find some interesting revelations here. Check it out. When you look at this text, how it begins to open up, how the word of God was going to come down like the dew upon the grass, and how this whole metaphorical language about nature points to us to the greatness of God, that God is so great. And all you got to do is look out at nature. The heavens still declares his glory. Why? Because he's still a great God. And God is so great. Here it is. God did not look for our opinion when he created the world. You see, when God put the sun to work, he put him to work during the day shift, and the moon to work the night shift. God scattered the stars from the backdrop of the universe. And God, he didn't stop there. He put wall-to-wall carpet on the earth, and he called it grass. And when God got through creating this world, he didn't wait for you or I to give him an applause. God congratulated himself and said that, yes, it is good. So if you think that that's something, then look at God's finest creation. Lord, look at how God made you. Nobody else has your DNA. Nobody else has your fingerprints. Nobody else has the dreams that you have or the visions that you had. You see, when God made you, think about it, he threw away the mold. And if you knew me about 5 years ago and you was to look at me right now, tell yourself, that's enough evidence to tell you that God is a great God. Searched all over, as the songwriter say, couldn't find nobody, because no one is greater, because he is a great God. Listen, God is righteous. God is sovereign, and God is great. But then, here, God is my rock. He is my rock. He is my place of stability. Where there is no stability, there is often gullibility as well as vulnerability. Let me say that again. Where there is no stability, there is often gullibility as well as vulnerability. But here in the process, you must understand that God is my rock. He is my solid foundation, because there will be things in the process that will attempt to uproot you from where God wants you to be. But see, God does not want to put blessings in the hands of people. He puts them in the hands of people who are in the proper spaces. And I'm trying to tell someone today, all you got to do is to get in the right space and the blessings will meet you there. Hallelujah. God is righteous. God is sovereign. God is great. And he is my rock and my salvation. Then here in the process, he restores us. God navigates our lives through a series of experiences. He says, now understand, if you don't know how to get through this process, Israel, go ask your fathers. And they'll tell you to ask the elders. They'll show you how the Most High God dealt with them. You see, Israel was generational, and everything they did was generational. So if you want to know how to get through this process, ask someone who went through it before. Because everyone is chasing destiny, but nobody really wants to deal with their history. You see, there's some wisdom in your history that's a launching pad for your destiny. He says, look at what God did, how God divided the nations. He divided their inheritance. He separated the sons of Adam. This is what God does. Watch how the restoration process takes place while you're in this situation. See, it's separation first, because what God did, he separated them. He intentionally separated them. You know that you're in the process when God begins to sovereignly and providentially separate you from some stuff. You see, some of us, when we come into relationships, it is our natural tendency that we come into a human relationship based upon people having it going on, right? You see, we want to connect with them because they're hot right now. We want to run down people and take selfies with them. We run them down because we want the people that's hot right now. But what God is going to do in your life, you see, he's not trying to connect you with people for the right now. He wants to connect you with people for your not yet. There were some relationships that you had, and they were significant in your life, and then all of a sudden it starts to go left, and you start saying, what did I do? And you start saying, wait a minute, did I do something? Did I offend them? And you start calling, and they never call you back. You inbox them, and they never inbox you back, and you start saying, wait a minute, what's wrong? Is it something that I did? And the answer to that is, you didn't do anything. God did it. You see, God frustrated that relationship because the people who you were holding dear to in this season did not have the capacity or the bandwidth to go where God was taking you. So God had to release them so that you wouldn't have them in your life later on. I'm trying to help somebody right here, because some people can't handle where God's about to take you. And here's a word for your life. Stop stalking people that God has released out of your life. And I think somebody ought to give God glory for your not yet. You see, if we would just stop whining over who has left us, then you might start seeing what's coming next in your life. God separated it. Wasn't nothing wrong? Some people are just designed to get you to a certain space, but they're not designed to get you into your orbit. You're going to abort your mission, holding on to stuff that could potentially threaten where God is trying to take you. If it doesn't fit, don't force it. Because you're not where you were, but you're not where you're going to be. And you're so close to where God has promised you that you can almost taste it and feel it. You're in the process. And everything that God's allowing you to go through is nothing but process. And I want you to let God have his way in your life. I want you to think about where God is taking you. And I want you to get a picture of it. And I want you to think about all the stuff that you're doing to try to be in control. And then let go. And let God. Because he's got it. All under control. Let go and let God. So until next time, may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide with you always. Amen.
Grace and peace, everyone. This is Pastor Davis. I pray that the word you heard today not only blessed your life at this particular moment, but I pray that the word you heard has met you at the right time and in the right situation, so that you know that you've heard from the Lord Jesus Christ today. And now you have an opportunity to establish a vibrant relationship with Jesus Christ. If you're ready, we encourage you to take that leap of faith and give your life to Jesus Christ. Just simply admit that you're a sinner in need of forgiveness. Then confess your sins. Thank God for Jesus' death on the cross that paid the price for your sins. Then ask Jesus to be the Lord of your life. Pray this with me. Dear Heavenly Father, I'm sorry for the wrong things I've done. Please forgive me. I believe your son Jesus died on the cross for my sins and rose from the dead. Jesus, come into my heart and be my Lord and my Savior. I surrender my life to you. Now, Father, help me to do your will. And thank you again for saving me. In Jesus' name I pray. If you prayed that prayer, congratulations. God just gave you eternal life. Please let us know by emailing us at the address below, and someone will contact you. We look forward to hearing from you. We love you in Jesus' name. God bless you, and welcome to the family.